not my idea of humanity. 8 billion people are there today. Why is it? This is because the cycles of misery are such, once you get into the trap, it keeps you going, and there's a whole society supporting that. People are telling you your misery is normal. Your misery is not normal. Your ill health is not normal. Every cell in the body is designed to create health. Why would they turn against us? We're doing something wrong, isn't it? Something fundamentally wrong. Is misery normal? No, every child is bursting with joy. If you just feed him enough, he's bursting with joy. What happened? What happened is we did all the wrong things. First and foremost thing that's happened is this, we have something called as education. Education is an extruder machine, which is trying to turn out the same kind of nuts and bolts from every human being, and we're turning out more nuts than bolts. The important thing is, one fundamental thing we missed out on is in education, we are giving so much significance to memory and no significance to human attention. See, when you're in school, you get good marks for whatever nonsense you read. If you can puke it on the examination paper, you get the marks. If you pay attention, you never got the marks. So this is a basic flaw in our way we are bringing up our children, the way we are raising whole generations of people. All of us are victims of it one way or the other, all right? Because everywhere your memory was rewarded, your attention was not rewarded. Because in this universe, in this life, things open up only where you pay intense attention. Where there is no attention, nothing happens, the same old cycle happens. So I am saying, right now misery is a certain cycle. It may be a genetic cycle, it may be a karmic cycle, or it may be an individually manufactured cycle, it doesn't matter how. But essentially it's a cycle. If you want to break any cycle, you need a very intense form of attention. So inner engineering, first aspect of it is learning to pay attention to yourself. When I say yourself, not your persona, not your thoughts, not your emotions, not like that, to the life that you are. See, first we are life, then we have thoughts, emotions, our psychological dramas, and then how we manifest that in the world, many, many things, all right? But fundamentally we are life. Everything else is secondary, but there is no attention to that life at all. Our personalities, our psychological drama has completely drowned the life that we are. Essentially, life is naturally exuberant and alive and joyful. This is the nature of everything, not just human life. But instead of being alive with life, we have become such a big psychological drama, now we don't know how to direct the drama, that is illness, isn't it? If you could direct your drama the way you want, then you would create a joyful drama for yourself or something that you enjoy. If you enjoy misery, it's fine with me, but you will do something that is good for you. But right now the drama itself is going out of control because drama has become bigger than the life that you are. This needs to change, means you need to engineer yourself in its right perspective, because this is how life is happening. Just because we are given a certain intellectual capability, unfortunately, instead of using it to our benefit, we are making it such a big problem. Every problem that we have created on the planet, whether it's environmental or political or wars and stuff and discriminations, everything has come from human mind, isn't it? What a fantastic instrument. Look at the way you're using it. This has happened because mind has become the master. You should be the master of your mind, then you will use it the way you want. Right now, the psychological process is a cycle of what information and data you have gathered from that, there is a cycle. That cycle is ruling you, that cycle is dominating you. If it's happening little well for you, you think it's great. The moment it turns into a tornado, then you are sick. That is not the point. The important thing is, you are not above it, you are beneath it. That is the problem.
I mean, there's so much to unpack. One of the things that really comes out is this idea that we've normalized an illusion. If the core nature of the human existence is to exude bliss, to be able to feel joy at a very high level, then most of the population believes that that's not true. So they're in an illusion. They're not free. They don't have the capability, or they have the capability, but they don't have the understanding that there can be another way. So part of the first step is to say, wait a second, the struggle that one finds themselves in, there is an alternative. You know, sometimes we can't start to change until we know there is a change that's possible.
See, instead of being a human being, we are still being human creatures. Mm. This is the problem. We have not established our way of being. When I say establishing our way of being, it is not that we have to think up something, how to be. I must be blissful. This is not an idea or a philosophy. There is enough scientific evidence to show only when you're in a pleasant state of experience, your body and your mind will function at its best. There's no question about it. And if you have to be successful in anything that you're doing, your body and your mind should function at its best. Only then you're successful. Now, what is this pleasantness of experience? See, if your body becomes pleasant, we call this health. If it becomes very pleasant, we call it pleasure. If your mind becomes pleasant, we call this peace. If it becomes very pleasant, we call it joy. If your emotions become pleasant, we call this love. If it becomes very pleasant, we call it compassion. If your very life energies become pleasant, we call this bliss. If it becomes very pleasant, we call it ecstasy. If your surroundings become pleasant, we call this success. Only in creating pleasantness in your surroundings, you need the cooperation and capabilities to create that. But to make body pleasant, mind pleasant, emotion pleasant, energies pleasant is 100% your business. Creating pleasantness in the surroundings, you need the cooperation of the people and the forces around you, otherwise it will not happen. But to make body, mind, emotion and energies pleasant, it's totally our business. This is what inner engineering is about. Tools, not philosophy, not teaching, not ideology, not belief system, tools to make it happen. As human beings, we have become the most dominant species, not because we are the strongest, because of our ability to use tools, isn't it? So we are talking about subjective tools. Without a tool, suppose whatever furniture you're sitting on, if I ask you to unscrew that with your hands, you may lose all the 10 nails and it won't come. If you put your teeth to it, you may lose some of them, it won't come out. But if I just give you a screwdriver, in a minute you'll take it out. That is the power of the tool. So, inner engineering is not a philosophy, not an ideology, not a teaching, not a new religion. It is a tool. Just learn to use it.
This has been fascinating. I mean, I have a million other questions, but can I ask you one final question before we say goodbye?
Yes.
I'm curious, what brings you joy?
Why something should bring you joy?
Well, I'm curious because I think a lot of people, you know, see your presence and, you know, experience your energy and, you know, you have something that I want, that Jonathan wants. You know, there's something very attractive about the way you have, you know, composed yourself and your thought and these tools. But I am curious, sort of on a personal level, what brings you joy? Like, what do you like to eat? What music do you like? What's joyful for you?
No, my joy doesn't depend on what I eat. Now I'm in America, so obviously I'm not eating what I want. this is where the problem is. We always think something brings us joy. Mm. See, when you are a five-year-old girl, you are simply bubbly, isn't it? What happened to that? When you were five, if you were so bubbly, by the time you're 40, you should be ecstatic. In natural process of growth, I'm saying, but just the reverse happens simply because there is no separation between what is you and what you gather. When I say what you gather, one thing is you gather this body. You were not born like this, slowly you gathered this body. and then you gather the impressions of the mind. And then you gather people and things around you, relationships, wealth, money, whatever else. What you gather must serve you well. But unfortunately, what you gather, you carry it on your head, the burden of it. See, it's like this. Someone was talking about this, so I painted some bricks in gold color, and 10 bricks. So say this is gold bricks, you carry it, because this person was always... somebody else is wearing 1 kilogram or 2 kilograms of jewelry, and they were struggling, so I said, here, I'm giving you gold bricks. They were not gold, I painted them gold, and said, put it on your head and walk all the time, enjoy it. So whether they're just mud bricks or gold bricks, the weight is same and the trouble is same. Your neck will break after some time. So the problem is what we carry, we don't understand that we need to carry it with a little distance. We carry it as ourselves. See, this body, what was soil became food. What was food became your flesh and bone. But now in your experience, it makes you feel this is you. What you gather can be yours, can never be you, isn't it so?
Mm-hmm.
What you gather can belong to you, can be yours, but it can never ever be you. So your physiological process and psychological process, if you learn to carry it with little distance, you don't have to bring joy in your life. You'll be bursting with it all the time. I'm not eating the food that I want to, but I'm still joyful.
Well, thank you, Sadhguru. You brought me and Jonathan tremendous joy getting to hear your wisdom. And it's really such an honor to speak with you. Jonathan, anything else you want to say?
It's so nice to speak with you. We look forward to being in person and having a longer conversation one day.
Thank you. Really, I'm in LA sometime this next month. Hope to catch up.
Let's do it.
We would love that. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Namaskaram.